Now let's take a look at what we can do with a 3x3 transformation matrix. First, let's take a look at the seemingly simple problem of translation. Let's say all you wanted to do is to take this image and translate it by tx in the x direction and ty in the y direction. So you have these very simple expressions, x2 equal to x1 plus tx and y2 equal to y1 plus ty. And the question is, can we represent these two equations using our 2x2 transformation matrix of the type that we saw before? And the answer is no, because there's no way to incorporate these constants here, the shifts tx and ty, into a 2x2 transformation matrix. So often you see this kind of a limitation arise, and you can solve it by bumping things up to a representation by one dimension. And that brings us to the concept of homogeneous coordinates. Very important concept, widely used in science and engineering to solve various kinds of representation problems and to keep things linear. So you have the homogeneous representation of a 2D point P, and that's xy, is a 3D point P tilde, which is x tilde, y tilde, z tilde. This third coordinate that you're looking at here, which is z tilde, is often called a fictitious coordinate. It's basically used to normalize the first two coordinates. So if you wanted to go from P tilde to P, you would say x is equal to x tilde divided by z tilde, and y is equal to y tilde divided by z tilde. So what does this really mean? Let's look at this from a geometric perspective. So imagine that this is your xy plane right here. And in this xy plane lies the point of interest, pxy. And so to look at what homogeneous representation means, we are going to erect a coordinate frame, x tilde, y tilde, z tilde, such that the xy plane lies at z tilde equal to 1, right here. And now, if you consider all the points on this line L that goes from the origin through the point P, we say all of these points are equivalent to one another, and they are equivalent to the point P. So every point on line L, except the origin, represents the homogeneous coordinate of P. So this is why it is redundant. You pick any point here, it corresponds to the homogeneous coordinates of the point P. So what does this really mean? It means that P is equivalent, this P, our P that we started off with, that can be expressed in homogeneous coordinates as xy1 in this coordinate frame, right? And you can multiply xy1 with some scale factor z tilde, and that's still equivalent to it because that would just slide it on the line, and that gives you x tilde, y tilde, z tilde, and that's some point on this line right here. So all points on this line represent homogeneous coordinates of the point P. So now, how does this help us? Let's come back to the problem of translation. We're trying to represent this in matrix form, and now it's easy to do. You can say xy1 on the right-hand side here, and now define a 3x3 matrix rather than a 2x2 matrix, and you see tx and ty in here, and if you multiply this out, you see that you indeed get these two equations. You have x2, y2, 1 on the left-hand side here. So is it just the translation that you can do with a 3x3 matrix? No, all the things that we did using the 2x2 matrix can of course also be done using the 3x3 matrix. So you can represent all of the things that we've discussed thus far using a 3x3 transformation matrix. This is scaling here. If you remember scaling, initially we were just using this part of it. And then you have skewing, which is essentially turning a rectangle into a parallelogram. You have translation, which we just discussed, rotation, etc. And now let's imagine that you wanted to first skew an image and then translate it and then scale it and then rotate it. You don't actually have to apply all of these in sequence. You can just compute the transformations and you can multiply those transformations in that sequence and you can get a composition which is a single transformation, a single 3x3 matrix that then you can apply to the image to get the same effect as the sequence of transformations that you wanted to do. So this class of transformations that we're talking about, they all lie under what are called affine transformations. So general form that we're looking at here is x1, y1, z1 on this side, multiplied by a 3x3 matrix gives you x2, y2, 1 on the left side. But what's interesting about this 3x3 matrix is that in all cases, you have 0, 0, 1 as the last row. And that makes it an affine transformation, which has essentially 6 parameters here. Okay, so the thing about the affine transformation, the properties are, the origin, of course, no longer necessarily maps to the origin. And that's because you have translation here itself, where you're shifting the origin. Lines map to lines. We can show this. Parallel lines remain parallel. And it's closed under composition, as we discussed. Okay, so now comes the main point, which is, what if we don't restrict the last row to be 0, 0, 1? We just allow it to be anything you want. It's just a 3x3 matrix. What is it in this case? Well, in this case, it's called a projective matrix. And that matrix is called a homography. So what does the projective matrix do? Well, a projective matrix essentially maps one plane to another plane. So this is plane one, this is plane two. But very special mapping, it maps it through a point. All the points on this plane are mapped to points in this plane, but through this point right here. That's what your homography does for you. And why is this interesting to us in imaging computer vision? Because that's exactly what a camera does, right? It's the same as imaging a plane through a pinhole. A pinhole is essentially what any camera has. Even if it's a lens camera, it has a central projection, which is your pinhole. And so whenever you have a plane in your scene, its mapping onto the image plane in a camera is a projective transformation that's given by a homography. This is why it's important to us, because as we'll see shortly, when we take multiple pictures of the scene by simply rotating the camera, you're essentially getting a set of images under certain conditions that are all related to each other via a homography. Okay, so one interesting thing about the projective transformation is, since we're using homogeneous coordinates here, you can multiply your point x1, p1 right here, which is x1 tilde, y1 tilde, and z1 tilde. You can multiply this by any scale factor, and you're going to get a point that's equivalent to this point. That's just the homogeneous representation. In other words, you could also multiply this homogeneous transformation, the matrix itself, with a scalar, and it's not going to make a difference to the outcome, which is the left-hand side right here, once you've normalized with respect to z2. So in other words, what this means is that whenever you have a homogeneous matrix, transformation matrix, you can only compute it up to a scale factor. There's always going to be that one ambiguity. In other words, we can actually choose to fix the scale of your homogeneous transformation matrix. We might just say that the magnitude of H is equal to 1. And so rather than 9 parameters, we have 8 free parameters in this case. So what are the properties of your projective transformation? One, the origin does not necessarily map to the origin. That's not surprising. Lines map to lines. We can actually show this by plugging in an equation of a line here and seeing that it comes out to be a line. Parallel lines do not remain parallel necessarily, and it's closed under composition. But this is the one that I want you to think about. Parallel lines do not necessarily remain parallel. This should be obvious to us now, because imagine that you have a plane in 3D and it has parallel lines on it. We know that in its image, the lines are not necessarily going to remain parallel, and that's what produces vanishing points, which we discussed earlier.